Welcome to Loyola Marymount University. I'm Fernando Guerra. I'm professor of political science and also professor of Chicano studies. I'm also director of the Thomas and Dorothy Levy Center for the Study of Los Angeles. Tonight, you're going to witness the Urban Lecture Series. This is a lecture series that's been going on here at the university for over 10 years. We bring all kinds of community, business, and nonprofit individuals to come and talk to us about issues facing our city. We hope you enjoy the show today and stay tuned for a great conversation about our great city. Welcome to Loyola Marymount University and the Urban Lecture Series, a series that discusses the challenges and events facing the city of Los Angeles. Today we're going to be talking about the March 8th election. Yes, there was an election on March 8th. It was a very significant day for Los Angeles. First and foremost, Loyola Marymount University inaugurated its 15th president in its entire history. Loyola Marymount University is both the oldest university and one of the newest university. It is the predecessor to St. Vincent's College, which was started in 1865. And of course, in 1973, Loyola University and Marymount College merged to form Loyola Marymount University. Our 15th president, he is the first non-Jesuit president in the history of the university. He is starting a trend that has been captured throughout the United States in terms of Jesuit universities that now have what we call lay presidents. So March 8th was very significant, and everybody must have been at Loyola Marymount University because nobody was voting. How many of you knew there was even an election happening on March 8th? Only 12% of voters turned out to express their favorite candidates. So we had both the city council, the school board, the community college board, and a variety of different ballot measures. Today, we're going to go over some of that data, and we're going to have a discussion with Alice Walton and Scott Svonkin, and I will introduce them in greater detail in a second when we get to them. But first and foremost, let's talk a little bit about the actual results, and then we will talk to Alice a little bit about some of the ballot measures and some of the other events happening on election day.
Actually, let me go backwards here. See.
Okay, what we have here is a show of the turnout during the presidential and gubernatorial elections just in the city of Los Angeles. These are just city of Los Angeles voters. And you can see that the turnout is not that bad. 83% of Los Angelino registered voters turned out to vote when President Obama ran in 2008. But you could see that it declined a little bit when we voted for governor this last time. And that is not unusual. It happens not only in California, but in most states and most cities. So this is a turnout that you see when we're running for president and for governor. Okay, and this is the turnout for mayoral elections. So you take a look real quick and you see that in 1997, only 11% of the voters turned out to vote for mayor. But in 2001, it was 38%, 2005, 34%, and then again, 18%. What explains that? Well, in 1997 and 2009, they were not competitive elections. The mayor in 97, Mayor Reardon, and in 2009, Mayor Villaraigosa were running for re-election with very, almost unopposed. There were over 20 candidates, I believe, in each one of those elections, but not significant candidates. Everybody knew that they were going to win re-election, and therefore voters didn't come out to vote. In 2001, Mayor Reardon had been termed out, and it was an open seat. And we had all kinds of people run for election. We had, obviously, the eventual winner, then city attorney James Hahn, who won, and also current council member at that time and former speaker of the assembly and now mayor, Antonio Villaraigosa, ran in 2001 and lost to Jimmy Hahn. We also had Congressman Becerra and a couple of other significant individuals. So it was a very competitive election. In 2005, we had another competitive election. Even though James Hahn was the incumbent mayor and could run and was running for re-election, he was once again challenged by Antonio Villaraigosa, who ended up beating him. But you do see that the turnout was a little bit lower than the previous one. And then finally, you see what happens in 2009. Okay. And this is the same thing we just saw. And here I'm doing is putting together the, there's the mayoral elections, but and here are the elections with no mayors like we had. So 12% this year, 2011, only 7% in 2007. 7% of the voters came out in 2007. 10% in 2003, a little bit higher in 1999. Okay. And then what I wanted to show you is we keep talking about the city of Los Angeles, school board elections, and community college elections. There is the boundaries for those three jurisdictions are different. The city of Los Angeles has its boundaries with its 4,000 square miles. The school district consists of the city of Los Angeles and about 20 other cities. Cities like Bell that you've heard about and Huntington Park, the little city of San Fernando, and cities like that are all part of the Los Angeles School District, and therefore they get to vote in city elections. Even larger than that is the Los Angeles Community College Board. And beyond that, Scott, how many cities are in the?
35 plus the city of Los Angeles.
So 36 cities.
36 cities total.
So 36 cities comprise the city, the Los Angeles Community College Board District. And so these are the three different jurisdictions that we're going to be talking about. At the core is the city of Los Angeles. The city of Los Angeles consists about, 80% of the Community College Board and about 85% of the school board. Okay, so there it is. This is the city boundaries. Okay, this is the school district boundaries, and you can see how much bigger they are, especially around here and down here in this area. Okay? Okay, all of this information will be on the center's website for those of you who aren't taking notes quick enough. So here's some basic demographic information for the city of Los Angeles. We see the population of the city is 3.7 million, but the 2010 census is going to count us at 3.8, almost 3.9 million. We have the adult population. What's the number one criteria that you need to vote? You have to be 18. So we took out, we subtracted those who are under the age of 18 and therefore not eligible. So we have an adult population of 2.9 million in the city. We then took out non-citizens. So we have about 900,000 adults who are not citizens that live in the city of Los Angeles and therefore not eligible to vote. So there's really only 2 million eligible voters. Of the 2 million, 1.6 or about 80% are registered to vote. So about 350,000 people who are eligible don't bother to register to vote. Of those 1.6 million, 190,000 or 12% voted in this March 8th election. Okay. I'm going to stop there for a second. I'm going to introduce our guest, and then we're going to take a look at some of the results in greater detail, and then we can ask some questions. I have sitting next to me Alice Walton, and she is the publisher and editor of the citymaven.com. It's an online news site about Los Angeles city politics. She's also the current vice president of the Greater Los Angeles chapter of the Society of Professional Journalists. Last year, Ms. Walton received her master's degree from Northwestern University Medill School of Journalism, which is considered one of the top journalism schools in the country, right after LMU, and where she was had a concentration in media management. Walton was a reporter with the City News Service from 2005 to 2009. She's also a graduate of USC, which is somewhere in the city, I don't know exactly where, and she's got a bachelor's degree in print journalism and political science. Miss Alice Walton. Next to her is Mr. Scott Svonkin. He is a school board member, businessman, and longtime community activist. He is currently a member of the San Gabriel Unified School District, which is actually part of the Community College Board District as well.
He believes in all kinds of issues that he's been pursuing. He's been a chief of staff for the state assembly. He's currently the senior advisor to Lee Baca, the sheriff of Los Angeles County. As a businessman with Prudential Insurance, he's a former member of Tom Bradley's staff and is community college instructor. I can go on and on about the many organizations that he's belonged to, a lot of the awards that he's won, and it will take up the whole show to be able to do that. Scott is right now a candidate for the Community College Board. He was on the ballot, and we're going to talk a little bit about his race, why he decided to run, why he didn't win, but he didn't lose either, and we'll explain what that means in a second. So first, let me go back to some of the actual results that happened. The city of Los Angeles is a what we call a progressive city, and state law, California law, requires that all cities in California run nonpartisan elections. That means that the candidates who run for office, such as Antonio Villaraigosa or Mayor Reardon or whoever, cannot run with a party label. Yes, we all know that Antonio's a Democrat because he was elected to the state legislature as a Democrat. He was the Democratic leader and the speaker. So everybody who follows politics realizes that he's a Democrat. But on the ballot, nowhere did it designate that he was a Democrat, and that's a nonpartisan election. So if you didn't know any of those things and you went to the ballot to vote, it wouldn't tell you who's a Democrat or who's a Republican. Okay, that's a nonpartisan election. It's state law, and it's really what we call a progressive reform. A second progressive reform is what we call staggered terms. And what we mean by staggered terms is that only half of a legislative local body is up for election. So on March 8th, we had half of the city council. All the city council districts that end in even numbers were up for a re-election. And that was a way to maintain stability, some say for the powers that be to maintain control, because not everybody would be ousted all at once, and you were able to protect some of the interests that had previously been on the council. But it also argued, some would make the argument, it provides for stability. So only half of the city council was up for election. Only half of the school board was up for election, and only half of the community college board was up for election. And that's, again, what we call staggered terms. A third progressive reform that is really taking hold in California, and the vast majority of California cities run their elections with this reform, is called at-large elections. At-large elections means that the entire district gets to vote for every single council member or community college board member. The city of Los Angeles does not have at-large elections. They have district elections. The school board does not have at-large elections. They have district elections. However, the community college board, which Scott Svonkin here is a candidate for, has at-large elections. That means everybody in how many square miles is the college board?
It's huge. There's over 2 million voters in the district. So
over 2 million voters, over 4.5 million people, right, and probably about 600 square miles, because I know the city is about 460 square miles.
Oh, it's so, at least double.
Yeah, so at least double. Okay, maybe let's say 800 square miles. We'll make that up and make it into a new fact. So this is a incredibly large district. And that means that Scott, as a candidate, had to reach out to all 2 million voters across close to half of L.A. County.
Right.
Okay, so it's an incredibly, incredibly large district. So what are the three reforms, again, that we're talking about? Nonpartisan elections, staggered terms, and at-large elections. And you saw those all play out in the Community College Board, and they certainly affect how elections are run. Reform that impacts LA elections is what we call off-year elections, or sometimes we call those as odd-numbered elections, meaning that the elections have it in odd-numbered years, 2011, 2013, as opposed to even-numbered years, when what occurs during even-numbered years? That's when we have presidential elections, elections for Congress, election for state legislature, elections for governor, and we have a higher turnout. In the data that you previously saw, you saw that there was an 83% of the city's voters came out to vote for Obama. Why don't we have the mayoral election at that same time when more people are going to come out to vote? Well, the argument against that is Well, everybody would be focused on Obama. Nobody would even know who's running for mayor. And with all the campaign ads that are happening, et cetera, it'd be very difficult for candidates like Scott running for College Board to be able to get his message out at the same time that the president or the governor or members of Congress or state legislature are also trying to get that out. So there's both pro and con about that in terms of having these odd year elections. So that kind of sets the more formal context for how these elections happen. Now we're going to get into a little bit more informal in terms of what occurred. There is, in all elections, not only here in Los Angeles and in California, but throughout the United States and throughout the world, that incumbency is king or queen, as the case may be. We all know that 96% of all members of Congress running for re-election will get re-elected. In most state legislatures, that's also the case. I think in this last election, even though Republicans had a tremendous ability to defeat some incumbents throughout the country, in California, not of the 53 members of Congress, I think 51 were all running for re-election. All of them won. In the state legislature, every single person running for re-election, which is about two-thirds of the state Senate and state assembly, running for re-election, they all won as well. There was not a single incumbent for the state legislature or California's congressional delegation that was defeated in 2010. And so we would expect some of the same things that would happen in 2011. So in 2011, in the city of Los Angeles, we had elections for city council and district 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, and 14. Again, the even numbered seats were up this time, okay? In those seats, only one seat was there not an incumbent running. In the others, the incumbents ran and they all won. And we'll go through some of them one by one, okay? And then the same thing in the both the school board and the college board. Right. All incumbents won. So give me 1 second while I find where I'm supposed to be on this thing here. Okay, so. Very quickly, let's take a look at these. They're really not that exciting, but I'm going to get one quick comment from each of our panelists about the race. In the second district, which is in the northeastern part of the San Fernando Valley, we had the incumbent council member, Paul Krikorian, running against, I never even heard of this guy before, or gal, I don't even know.
It's a man.
Yeah. Visani. Yeah. Okay. Alice Park-Ricorian was a former state legislator who ran in a special election and got elected. Do you want to say anything about this election?
Well, I think he was probably really happy. He had a very tough race in 2009. It was an open seat. It was a very competitive, very hard-fought race. And so I think this was probably a nice little vacation for him.
Scott?
Paul had built already a broad coalition. He was effectively engaging the community, which you have to do on the LA City Council. And so no serious challenger ran. This is somebody he beat in the special election, which had lots of candidates. And Paul had a pretty easy ride.
Basically boring.
Yeah.
Very boring.
Okay. District number 4, Tom Labonge. He won with 55% of the vote. He had two other candidates. In any of these elections, if you do not get 50% plus one, you have to have a runoff, and the runoff is scheduled for May 17th. Okay, and we'll talk about turnout. We know that turnout was 12%. It is my guess that turnout on May 17th will be lucky if it's 5%.
I've heard predictions as low as 4.
Okay. Only 4 or 5% of voters will come out, and we'll talk about why and what Scott's going to do during that time. I did get a call from Councilman Tom Labonge, and he said he might drop by. Okay, so we'll save this one for that time, and I don't want our guests to say anything because then as soon as he comes here, we'll say, you know, Alice said this about your election, so we're gonna.
I would say it to his face.
Oh, okay, okay then, Alice.
Oh, he has a surprisingly challenging race. Yeah. It's very unusual that city council races are competitive. He's been an elected official for 10 years. He's worked for the city since the summer of 1974. And yet he had two challengers this time who had very little money compared to him, but one, Tommaso Grady, who got 30% of the vote, got endorsed by the LA Times, and the other gentleman, Stephen Box, got endorsed by the Daily News. So there were definitely surprises in the race, and I think it surprised probably even the councilman.
Right, and why was he not endorsed by those two newspapers?
The city is in such a bad shape right now, financially, business-wise, and I think there was a sense that the councilman is not a great policy guy. He's very focused on constituent services, and I think there was a sense from both papers that maybe somebody else would be more focused on grand policy and really saving pensions and the budget and things like that.
Okay. And we'll talk to him if he is able to make it. So he wasn't scheduled to be here. I just happened to talk to him and told him we were doing this. He says, I'd like to come by. So, okay. And that's the kind of guy that he is. That's why he got in trouble. Okay. Council numbers, district number six, also in the San Fernando Valley. Scott, comments?
Well, this is a number of candidates that run every time. And so Councilman Cardenas had a pretty easy race. Tom, I think it's in his, is this his last term?
Yes, it is.
So a number of the council members are in their last term. Generally, you don't field as an incumbent in your last term unless you've done something wrong. You don't field an opponent. So Tony had a pretty easy race. He got almost 60% of the vote. None of his opponents raised any significant money or had any support from any of the major groups, as far as I know.
Oh, the only exception would be Rich Goodman was endorsed by the Times.
Okay.
In a total surprise, and there was no reason for it, even in the endorsement. That was the only blip of the entire race, I think, in months.
Okay, right. And what does the endorsement mean when the LA Times endorses you and still you only get 18%?
Yeah, it's completely meaningless.
So everybody wants that endorsement.
Well, you do. As a candidate, you want to be endorsed by the LA Times or the Daily News because it gives you something to tell the public. If you don't have the resources to communicate it, it doesn't help you very much. In my race, the LA Times and the Daily News didn't endorse any of the community college candidates. The only paper that I know that endorsed was the Sentinel, the Los Angeles Sentinel, and I was honored as the white guy in the race to get the African-American newspaper. So if you work hard and you have a story to tell, newspapers will surprise people often. And so, but you've got to be able to communicate. The LA Times helps you if you have the money to tell people.
Okay, next one. This is an interesting one. We're going to start with you, counting. Scott, and get you closer to the mic.
Though. Okay.
Okay. This is the 8th district. We round it up. We say he has 51%. Now, what did I say? You need 50% plus one vote to win. Okay. Right now, he has 50.06%.
Right.
He's got 140 votes less, and he drops under the 50%, and he would have to be in a runoff. And even though this happened a week ago, we still haven't finished counting all the ballots.
Right. Scott? Well, I actually called the city clerk's office who counts the ballots just to check in and see when we'll know who's in what runoff. I'm pretty sure that I made the runoff because I've got 35% of the vote. My next closest opponent is at 15.
Well, don't talk about that. We're going
to
get
to that. Okay, we'll get to that. In this race, the organized labor was unhappy with Bernie Parks. The councilman had not supported job programs at the labor community likes, and therefore they spent millions of dollars for Hogan Rawls, and she was a surprise because she had very little money. I think she raised less than $100,000 herself.
I think she was at maybe about $20,000
when
she started putting money in.
But organized labor spent millions of dollars and made this a close race. There are 40,000 votes being counted as we speak. The city clerk says they should be done this week.
But that's 40 citywide,
citywide,
not in the district.
Right. But those 40,000 votes could determine this race.
Absolutely.
That's true. I will tell you, the feeling in City Hall is that Parks is probably going to be okay.
Mm-hmm.
His office went through and did a very rough estimate on how many ballots are left within the district, and then looked at the statistical analysis between what Bernard got, what Fressy got, right. And actually there was the third candidate, Jabari, who got a couple of votes. And they think statistically it's too difficult for her to come back.
That's true.
But right, so here's someone who's been in public office for a very long time, I think almost a decade.
Who is Bernard Parks?
He's the former chief of police. He was let go.
He was not rehired.
Right. By the police commission.
That's a euphemism for being fired.
He was basically fired when Jim Hahn was mayor. He became a councilman. He's very big on the budget. He's known as being rather fiscally conservative on the council, which is unusual. Mm-hmm. And right, that has made him extremely unpopular with Labor, who spent $1.2 million on someone that most people had not heard of before.
Meaning the other candidate.
Right, Hogan Rolls. And with all that money, he now is at, I think it's like 50.89%. Right, waiting. The clerk says that they will tell us hopefully by the 22nd.
I'm told that by the end of this week, they're going to finish counting.
Okay. Right. I'm told they'll tell the media by the 22nd, but they actually have until the 29th to certify the results. So there's somewhat of a waiting game. Although I talked to Parks and he said, I feel very comfortable, you know.
Has he declared victory?
He declared that night, but his opponent has not conceded.
Okay.
And she will not concede until the clerk counts every single last vote.
So in 2010, we had another local candidate who declared victory. Do you remember that, Scott?
The attorney general's race?
Yes.
Yes. Steve Cooley. Steve Cooley, I was in the room, actually. Steve Cooley declared victory, and about a week later, Kamala Harris was declared the winner in that race. So our L.A. County District Attorney stood up and did what every political expert says not to do. If it's too close a race on election night, you thank your supporters. You don't declare victory until all the ballots are counted. We now have the first African-American woman attorney general, and Steve Cooley on election night had declared he won.
Okay. Steve Cooley is the district attorney for Los Angeles County, a county that has 9.8 million people. It's got about 6 million voters.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so everybody expected that Steve Cooley would be the only Republican for sure to win statewide office because he had been so successful in winning in a Democratic jurisdiction, meaning Los Angeles County. And so that if he could capture the same amount of votes that he typically did when he was DA, that especially running for Attorney General, which is a very similar post, but at the statewide level, that he was a shoo-in. Okay, and so many of us did that analysis and said, hey, he's going to win because of his home base of Los Angeles County. What happened?
Well, people saw, I think a couple things happened. Number one, he didn't run as aggressive a campaign as Kamala Harris did. He made a mistake and talked about his benefits in a way that the public didn't appreciate. He talked about the idea that he was going to take his retirement and he was going to also take the AG's salary. And the public was, I think, disappointed or outraged. The other thing is this was the first race he had to run as a Republican.
That's correct.
And so in California, Democrats generally win, and we had Megabucks Meg Whitman on the statewide ballot who dragged Steve Cooley, who's a moderate Republican, down. Steve Cooley's one of the people in California that's more moderate than many Republicans. That's my take, Alice?
I think you're right. I mean, I think a huge embarrassment for him was this issue of the pension. I think part of it was even he said he was going to be taking a pay cut by becoming attorney general at a time where people are losing their jobs and their houses. Also, I don't know how well known he is outside of L.A. County. And so to not be more aggressive cost him, you know.
But earlier in the program, we talked about nonpartisan elections. State law requires that city, county, and school district elections be nonpartisan, where you cannot have your party identification on the ballot. So Steve Cooley, when he runs for district attorney, the voter does not know by the ballot that he's a Republican. When he's running for a statewide office, that's a partisan election, and you have your party identification. So every voter knew that he was a Republican. So many Democrats who voted for him in Los Angeles County now said, oh, he's a Republican, I'm not voting for him. And that's what happened, and really, it cost him the race. Bernard Parks also ran for, it was on that same ballot that we're talking about, November 2010. He was on the ballot, and he was on the ballot for county supervisor against then state senator Mark Ridley Thomas, and he lost that election. And talk a little bit about that election, Alice.
Yeah, that was a particularly nasty race. These two men are not friends, or knockheads quite often. And again, I think that was the case where you saw Labor really come out in support of now Supervisor Ridley Thomas. There was a lot of money in that race. When I was talking to Councilman Parks about this current race, he said, well, were you surprised by the amount of money that Labor put into the council race? He said, of course not. They put in $10 million in the county supervisor race.
That's amazing. $10 million by organized labor to elect a candidate. That's a record in Los Angeles County. That's clearly a record in California. And without doing extensive research, I'm 99.9% sure that that's a record in the nation for a local office. $10 million, half the state governors who win do not spend that much money in total. And this was for a local county board of supervisor district. It shows you how important it is, and it shows you the role of labor in LA politics. So this is still wait and see. This is undecided. I do think that Councilman Parks is going to pull it off. I think it's difficult. She would have to win about 61% of the remaining ballots, and so that's not likely to happen. And so he does feel comfortable about that. This was the most exciting race for the council seat to watch. Again, Councilmember Parks, former police chief, a current council member, and looks like he will be reelected in district number 8. District number 10. Snow White and the Dwarfs. Alice?
Yes, this is a race that I got almost no attention, and I think you can see why. I would say Councilman Wesson did not have any serious challengers, and the best way to put that is at least not serious challengers in terms of finance, which is really where a lot of the power comes in this race. So mainly, Councilman Wesson has a pretty low profile, I'd say, on the council, although now there's rumblings that maybe he's looking to run for mayor or run for different offices. But again, this was a pretty quiet race in the 10th.
Scott?
Well, I had the opportunity to work with Councilman Wesson when he was Speaker of the California Legislature. So Herb is a dynamic politician. He is very popular in his district, as you can see. You don't get to 74% in a crowded race unless you're popular. And I would not be surprised if his commercials for his last round of campaigning sounded much like a candidate for Los Angeles mayor.
Okay.
In one of his commercials a while back, he invoked Mayor Tom Bradley, who I worked for in my young days, in my youth. He invoked his memory, and that is something that you signal when you're running for citywide office.
Right. And again, we noticed that Councilmember Wesson is the former state legislator, former Speaker of the California Assembly. We've already mentioned that Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa is a former Speaker.
Right.
We talked about Bernard Parks being the former police chief. We first mentioned Paul Krikorian. He was a former state legislator. We previously mentioned Tony Cardenas in the 6th district. He was a former state legislator and chair of the budget in the state legislature. Mm-hmm. And so it's been a very significant a group of people who are running for City of Los Angeles. City of Los Angeles city council members are the highest paid city council members in the country. They make, I think, $170,000 a year, and they do have pensions, unlike the state legislators. District number 12. This is the only district where there was not an incumbent running for reelection. Councilman Craig Smith, even though he could run for one more term, decided not to seek reelection. He had had enough. And so it was a, quote unquote, an open field. And yet we see that Mitch Englander received 58% of the vote. And a guy named Smith, who I think some of the voters confused as the former council member, got 25% of the vote because he did not run a very active race. Alice?
Right. So there was no incumbent in this race, except that there sort of was with Englander. He's the chief of staff to the current councilman.
Right.
And the current councilman was the chief of staff to the former councilman in that district. So there's somewhat of a pattern here. He also did an incredible job with fundraising. He really started the campaign season with about $400,000. I think he finished with well over $500,000.
Right. Now, wait, to raise that money, nobody can give you more than $500, okay? So for you to have $500,000 means you needed 1,000 people
to give you $500?
He was really, he was very busy. I mean, as soon as the period opened where he could fundraise, I think it was 2 years ago, he just went for it. And he didn't loan himself any money, unlike some other candidates. So, right, that was all donations.
Scott?
Well, Mitchell Englander, as was mentioned, was chief of staff. He was well-positioned to run. He put together a huge coalition. Almost everybody in City Hall, everybody in county government backed him. He's a LAPD reserve. The interesting thing about Brad Smith is Brad Smith tried to capitalize on being a Democrat, but in that district, it doesn't really play very well. The San Fernando Valley is, Los Angeles is predominantly Democrats or Democratic, but in that district, they're more conservative. These are all people that live in fairly affluent communities. And so he didn't get very much in the way of legs by being the Democrat in the race. But oftentimes in Los Angeles, trying to differentiate yourself from a Republican, which Mitchell is easy to do. With Mitchell, he put together a coalition of Republicans and Democrats, so it didn't make it easy for Brad to run a very good campaign. He also didn't raise very much money.
Well, Brad's other problem is he dropped out of the race at one point, and he never explained why he did that, but he dropped out of the race for about a week or two and then sent out an email in the dead of night saying he was back in the race.
Why do you think?
I believe there was a potential conflict of interest with his employer that he hadn't cleared. But he was never really upfront about the reason. He didn't do a great job of communicating his message. And I think for voters, to see somebody dropped out of the race and then came back in is probably very unsettling. You're looking for a real leader, and that's not a great leadership quality.
So Scott mentioned that Mitch Englander is a Republican. He is replacing the only other Republican in the city council. There are 15 city council members in Los Angeles. Of the 15, there's one Republican, which is about equal representation, and then Dennis Zine is declined to state, though I think he was formerly registered.
He was a Republican when he first ran for office.
Right, but he's seen the light, so he's become and so that means that there are 13 Democrats.
Right.
Okay, and even though you don't run as a member of a party on these elections, we all know what you are, because it's actually, you can actually look up somebody's registration. You can go to the city clerk's office or their website, and you can actually look up a friend of yours's registration, whether they're registered as a Democrat, Republican, or declined to state. So don't be afraid to put that on your Facebook, because it's already public information anyway. So we now have only 18% of registered voters in the city of Los Angeles are Republican. And so they're all in that corner in that district that Scott was talking about in Mitch Englander's district.
Northridge and Chatsworth. Yeah.
District number 14, Jose Huizar, 64, almost two-thirds of the vote, and candidate Martinez with 36%. As a journalist, this must have been the most fun race.
This was the ugliest, most demanding race I have ever covered. Which is surprising when you see that the incumbent got 64% of the vote. Why would it be so ugly? Mm-hmm. So you have two men here, Jose Huizar, the councilman, and Rudy Martinez, who used to be best friends. And then they had a falling out, it sounds like over money. They both have different versions of what happened. And they had a very extreme falling out because they started this race and they had allegations of money laundering, FBI investigations, stealing money. I think beating wives came up once, former arrests.
Sounds like a Mexican novella.
And then, well, to cap it off, on Super Bowl Sunday, the political consultant running Jose Huizar's campaign, he was really upset that the LA Times had gotten, had endorsed Rudy. Allegedly, the FBI was investigating the councilman, which does not seem to be true. So he sent this very juicy email to his little team saying that they were going to put a political bullet in the opponent's head and make him pee his pants and release the dogs of Satan on him and wish he had never been born. And then surprise, surprise, somebody forwarded that email to the campaign and they filed a police complaint.
So it was great.
Yeah, he claimed he was afraid for his life. By the way, that was not the consultant for the campaign. That was a day-to-day campaign manager. So it was a lower-level person in the campaign.
It was a campaign worker, though.
Yeah, not that low. I mean, it was like the number two guy in the race. Okay.
And in campaigns, when you're supporting somebody, not to say that that's okay, because it's not. That kind of rhetoric is something that we need to call into question.
And tone down.
Yeah, it's not okay to use that kind of rhetoric. But folks, like in locker rooms, things happen that we don't approve of. On campaigns, things happen that I would never support. And he was immediately either resigned or dismissed.
Correct. And it was the political bullet in the forehead that was really the kicker. Had that not been in there.
Given what happened in Tucson.
Right. It wouldn't have been as bad. It was hugely embarrassing. He was immediately fired, sort of.
Fired or quit. Yeah. Well, the other thing is that was interesting about this race is law enforcement played a significant role. Sheriff Lee Baca, who I work for, was with the incumbent, Jose Huizar. Rudy Martinez had relationships with law enforcement. There was some question about he had possession of a badge of a deceased policeman, and then they engaged the family. And it just got really, as you said, it was one of the ugliest races. But the outcome is interesting because Jose won by a significant margin, and Rudy Martinez spent a lot of money, and he was producer of a TV show, reality show?
He was one of the stars of, I think it's called Flip This House. That's a home renovation show on A&E, and he owns a bunch of different restaurants. And he gave himself $200,000 in this race.
Which is huge, folks. $200,000 is a lot of money in a political race, especially to invest that. And it looked like this was a grudge match, not a political campaign.
$200,000, that's almost enough to go to Loyola Marymount for 4 years. Almost. All right, the school board, Board of Education, District 3, Scott?
Well, I have worked as a school board member for 3 years, and this was an interesting race because...
But not for LA Unified.
For San Gabriel Unified. No, I serve on the San Gabriel Unified School Board, so I know a little bit about school board races. This was interesting because Luis Puglisi has run for other seats. So he's a candidate that ran in another district and lost, and so he ran in this one. He never got much traction. Tamar ran for city council and lost to...
Krikorian.
Well, yeah, Krikorian. I'm not sure how far she got in the race. Did she drop out or did she lose?
No, she lost. Okay. Yeah. She came in third or fourth.
Right.
And so the constituents were angry with her because she had made a pledge not to leave her first school board term. But Luis was not a very strong candidate, so she won pretty easily. She also had the backing of the mayor, but this was interesting because she had promised not to run for city council. She did. She ran and lost, and then decided to run for re-election.
Okay. District 5.
This one, we don't know the winner.
Okay, it says right here, these are kind of misnomers. It should be reversed, but neither one is...
He's at 49.5% last time I checked. In all of the races in Los Angeles, in order to prevent yourself from being in a runoff, you have to get 50% plus one, as the professor said. And in this race, Luis Sanchez put together a huge coalition. He's the chief of staff for sitting school board president Monica Garcia, and he put together a very big coalition. Everybody was supporting Luis. There was Fernandez was endorsed by the teachers union, and then because of some financial issues, the UTLA pulled their endorsement and moved it to Bennett Kaiser. Bennett Kaiser's run for office before. They put $1 million, I'm told, into Bennett Kaiser. Luis Sanchez this is an interesting fight. Teachers union against SEIU, which represents the cafeteria and janitorial workers. Two big unions fighting it out. Sanchez is 0.5% away from winning this race. And so he has lawyers, and SEIU, I'm told, have lawyers down looking at the ballot counting, because if he can get to 50% plus one, he wins in the primary. If he has a runoff, he goes from a 10 or 11% turnout to a 4 or 5% turnout. If you can't predict who's going to go vote, you can't tell if you're going to win or not. So Sanchez and his supporters are spending a lot of money and have attorneys watching the ballot counting, and that race could be determined in the next week or two.
So we had Councilmember Parks, who is at 50% plus 140 votes.
Right.
We have candidate Sanchez, who is at 49%. And I think he needs 300 votes.
Yeah.
300 votes. And I think there's still like 3,000 votes to be counted in that
district.
In that district. And so this is undecided at this particular moment. So this data, though, is from the day of the election. That's why the numbers are so off. When the up-to-date numbers have them at 49%. Okay, and then District 7. Scott?
Dr. Vladovic's a very popular candidate. The teachers union endorsed Jose Escandone, who had some driving problems and dropped out. The UTLA endorsed him and then found out that he had some criminal issues in his background. So Escandone dropped out. Vladovic won easily because he didn't really have an opponent. They did, I think UTLA either tried to or was considering endorsing Love, but never really got behind him. And I don't know if they actually ever endorsed him. But Dr. Vladovic had Mayor Villaraigosa, who spends a lot of money and has a lot of interest in reforming the school district. And Dr. Vladovic's a former deputy superintendent of LA Unified, very good guy and well positioned to solve these difficult problems. So he had the backing of both the mayor and SEIU.
Okay. Next, we're going to take a look at the Los Angeles Community College Board District. This is a district that runs the community colleges of Los Angeles, and I think there's nine of them?
Nine campuses.
There's nine campuses. The closest one to us, of course, is West LA College,
right.
But it also includes East Los Angeles College, LA Trade Tech, mm-hmm. Los Angeles City College, Mission College.
Valley Pierce. Trade.
A very significant jurisdiction, very important for higher education. The district had, the LA Times ran a series of articles right before mm-hmm. the election. Now, the elections, as I mentioned before, are at large. It means you run throughout the whole district, okay? And then the seats are not districts, but you run for a particular office. Now, you have to remember that at-large elections, you can organize them two ways. One way is just to have one ballot, and the top three or four, in this case, would win the office, irrespective of what office you're running for. Or, as in the case of Los Angeles Community College, you can have specific offices that you run for. Okay? There were two incumbents running for re-election.
Correct.
And then two open seats. That means the incumbents decided not to run for re-election. Okay? Scott Svonkin, a member of the San Gabriel Unified School District, which is within the community college district, okay, decided to run for community college. Number one, why did you decide to run? Number two, why did you decide to run in the office that you ran for instead of the other office where somebody else ran and easily won?
Yeah.
Okay. And then, let's start with just those two questions.
Well, first of all, I've wanted to be on the LA Community College Board for many years. I was the student trustee at Pasadena City College, and community college turned my life around. As a youngster, couldn't talk about this, but at 45 today, I can tell you, I was a high school dropout, and Pasadena City College turned my life around. And so I owe community college my life. I have been, I think, relatively successful working for Mayor Bradley, being chief of staff for a California legislator, working for Sheriff Baca, owning my own business. I have a beautiful family. I have a wife and two lovely kids, and I serve on the San Gabriel School Board. So I'm running for a very personal reason. If community colleges weren't there, I wouldn't be where I am today. And so my goal is if elected on May 17th, that I will fight for every student, whether they're going to 4 years university after community college, or whether they just want a new start in life and a job. So that's why I'm running.
Okay, so let's take a look at your race here. You got 37%, by far more than anybody else. So you're going to face off with Gutierrez. Is that a given, or is Pescador still a possibility?
It's unlikely. Most likely, Lydia Gutierrez will be my opponent.
Okay.
And by the way, the reason I picked seat five is that a number of years ago, I had wanted to run, and actually I applied when there was a death of a trustee, they appoint. And seat five was the seat that Georgia Mercer was appointed to. I went up against her. I was 32 years old and young, worked for Paul Koretz, and I didn't know how the political process worked. I wasn't able to get the teachers union and all the backing that I needed at 32. At 45 today, I have the backing of almost every elected official and organization in LA. At 32, I didn't know how the system worked. So I decided to go for seat five because Georgia Mercer was retiring. I wish I'd picked seat three because I would have had one opponent and I would have won probably on the election day on March 8th, but now I have a runoff on May 17th.
Okay, so we're talking about office number 3 and office number 5, and literally there is no difference.
None.
Other than the number. You will represent the same geographic area. It's the same voters. You'll have the same power. Everything is exactly the same except for the office number.
Right. And I was mistaken. I've been in politics and public service half my adult life. And so I went down the day filing opened, and I filed for seat 5. And I had the support of almost every elected official on the city council. I had Sheriff Baca. I had Xavier Oslovsky. I had put together a coalition, a huge coalition. I had raised almost $100,000. And these are offices where you don't raise a lot of money. I thought if I filed first and folks understood that I was a strong candidate, they wouldn't file to run against me. Little did I know, 6 people who didn't either know who I was or either they knew and thought they could beat me, they all filed. And in this group, there are 4 Republicans. There are 3 Latinos, 1 Asian American, 1 African American. It was a crowded race, and nobody could predict what was going to happen. So it was a tough race, and it's going to be a tough runoff, mostly because very few people will bother to vote, and that's the sad part. But if enough people go out and vote, that 37% will be 60% or 65% in the runoff.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember who I voted for. I can't remember who I voted for in that election. So. Alice, this is the only, potentially the only one of 2 runoffs. Here's Scott. We don't have Tom LaBange for you to talk to, but you can talk to Scott right here.
Okay, so if you have 4% turnout on May 17th, because it sounds like very little else will even be on the ballot.
Right.
You talked about it's difficult to win if you don't know who is going to go vote. So as a candidate, what is your strategy or what is your plan to identify who might vote and who's going to be really receptive to your message?
Well, I'm really lucky because I've put together a coalition that includes Republicans and Democrats. I have Sheriff Baca, Don Kanabi, Mayor Reardon all backing me. Those are all Republicans, Mayor Reardon's former mayor of Los Angeles. I also have every Democratic leader in Los Angeles. I've got the entire Los Angeles City Council. So I have Mayor Villaraigosa, Speaker John Perez. I've got 9 members of the United States Congress and 3 county supervisors.
You probably listed everybody that's going to vote on that.
If I can turn out just my supporters, I have a good shot at winning. But it's going to be tough because there are hopefully the people that vote in the special congressional election, which was called yesterday, will probably vote for a candidate like me. They'll want someone with experience in both government and business. My opponent is a school teacher. She's supported by the Tea Party. I'm a lifelong Democrat, but supported by Republicans and Democrats. So I'm more of a centrist candidate. I've reformed my school district. I've proposed significant reforms on the College Board. Last week, I returned $11,000 that I had received from contractors and said, I'm not taking money from contractors because I don't want there to be even the appearance of a conflict of interest. The LA Community College Board has been under investigation, basically, by the LA Times, and there's a DA investigation into an administrator. And I work for Sheriff Baca. My reputation is all I've got, folks. So I'm going to run the cleanest, most aggressive campaign I can. I'm not going to take money from contractors because I don't want people, when I vote, if elected, to say he's doing something wrong. I want to be able to be independent, and I want to be able to reform the system and bring true transparency. So I sent a message.
Sounds like a good campaign speech. Yeah. So let me ask you, though. We talked earlier about the unions. They spent $8 million to help Mark Riley Thomas win the supervisors race. They spent $1.2 million trying to defeat Councilman Parks, and they were very significant in other elections. Where are the unions going to be in your election?
Well, I'm proud that working men and women support me.
I was talking about the unions.
Yeah, those are the people I'm talking about. Teachers, community college teachers are backing me, and I'm proud to have their support. The people that turned my life around were the instructors in the classroom, like people like you.
Oh, thank you.
And when instructors and professors make a difference in your lives, that's a good thing. So the community college instructors, all of organized labor, are backing me. But the good news is that I have a record of reform that I can run on. I've cleaned up things in my district. I've required competitive bidding. I've proposed in the LA Community College that we put on our website everybody who gives a donation. Currently, you have to go down to Norwalk, dig through some files and find out who's given. I'm proud. My two largest contributors are my wife and I, who decided not to buy a hybrid car this year, and we invested that money. I loaned myself $25,000.
So you're driving around polluting is what you're telling me.
I am for a year until I win. And then, but we contributed $25,000. And my aunt, who's a social worker, gave my campaign $25,000. So the next large.
That's a nice aunt.
That is a nice aunt. She's single and she's able to help. She's always supported me. So I believe I have the broad support that you need to win this race. But I'm proud to have organized labor in my corner. The LA County Federation of Labor endorsed me, but that represents millions of workers. And as you've seen, generally the people they support, with the exception of Bernie Parks, win.
Yeah. Sure. Let's very quickly take a look at the other, and then we're going to get to some of the initiatives. So we had seat three. Here we only had two candidates. So one was going to get 50% plus one.
Right.
And that was Steve Veras. That was the other open seat that Scott could have easily run for. Steve Veras is also a current elected official. He's council member for the city of San Fernando.
Right.
Alice?
I will tell you, I really don't know much about the community college district, I have to tell you.
Steve had a proven record. Joyce Burrell Garcia had run before, didn't develop her name's Joyce Burrell Garcia, African-American woman running on her Latino former married surname. She didn't get a whole lot of traction. She was part of a Republican reform slate who didn't have a lot of money and didn't run a very good campaign, and so she lost. But Steve is an experienced staffer. He's district director for Kevin DeLeon. He's smart. He's been successful in San Fernando. And this was, I think, a smart next move for him in his career. And community college made a difference in his life. Both his parents turned their lives around as far as careers at community college. So he had a personal reason for running.
Yeah, then he went on to UCLA and
right. He's
actually working on a PhD right now as well.
Right.
So district number one, Mona Field, easily won. She's the incumbent.
This was an interesting race because this was not Mona's seat. Seat number one was Sylvia Scott Hayes' seat, who decided not to run. And she was mentioned in the LA Times stories, having asked people to hire her niece and nephew, which I believe should be banned. I don't believe elected officials should be asking people to hire their kids.
Your aunt gave you money. Now you're against hiring nieces and nephews?
Yes, I am. Because in one case, my aunt is helping me get elected, and that's right. Public. Asking the public to pay for my aunt to work for them, I wouldn't do that.
Okay, so you're not going to hire her then?
I'm not going to hire her if elected. But Mona didn't run as an incumbent, which was one other interesting fact. She ran as a community college teacher, which she's been. Uh-huh. She had a group of folks that were underfunded, and she decided at the last minute to run for this seat.
What seat was she in before?
She was in seat three. One was Sylvia Scott Hayes's. But because it doesn't really matter which seat you run in, because they're all at large, when she decided to run, she picked seat one.
Okay. So seat one, seat three, seat five, and then finally seat seven.
Miguel Santiago is a current incumbent. He's district director for John Perez, a very bright young man. And he won. His opponent was unemployed, and I guess that's not a good thing to be when you run for office.
Yeah, but community colleges are supposed to help you turn your life around.
They do, but I don't think they want people who need to turn their life around on the board.
Okay. So in addition to city council seats, the school board and the community college board, also on the ballot were a lot of initiatives. And we've asked Alice to really come in and comment about those. Number one, there were many more initiatives than there usually are. On a typical off-year election like we had today, you'll probably see two or at the most three or four. Mm-hmm. Okay, how many did we have this time and why did we have so many?
Well, the why is a good question. There were 10 ballot measures this time, and actually there was an effort to make it 11, so it could have been even more, but there were 10 ballot measures. I think there was a couple reasons for this. Two of the measures were actually taxes. One was a tax on medical marijuana dispensaries, and one is a tax on oil extraction within the city. So I think that's very reflective of the fact that the city is in a huge financial hole, and the council members who vote to put these on the ballot are really looking for any way to find additional revenue for the city.
We're going to tax marijuana, even though most marijuana dispensaries are nonprofits.
Well, they all have to be.
And they have to be by law. And then most of them aren't really licensed, so we don't know where they are.
This is how you know that nobody read their ballot, because this passed, even though it was opposed by the chief of police, it was opposed by the DA, by Sheriff Baca, it said in the ballot, if we pass this, we'll get sued. It opens us to liability. The city attorney said, don't do it. Right. We don't know how many dispensaries there are in the city. Half of them are illegal. They're nonprofits. There's nothing to tax. And if we tax them, then we're basically saying that marijuana is a legal drug, which, of course, it's not under federal law. And that passed.
Okay. Who put it on the ballot besides the audience out here?
So the council did vote for it. The only two council members who eventually came out in support of it were council members Paul Kretz and Janice Hahn. And there was also a lot of misinformation on this one. The supporters were saying this will raise $10 million a year, which sounds pretty good if you need money, $10 million a year, except that it's not true. So, but nobody read the ballot and it passed.
So what does it mean?
It means that the lawyers are going to be really busy for the city.
Oh, okay. I guess, but we've seen consistently, though, in California that we've been supportive of marijuana, medical marijuana. It's,
right. And I think the city,
although Proposition 19 did not pass.
Right. That didn't pass. And the city is, I would say, supportive in part based on their action, but they have completely bungled how they regulate dispensaries. And because they've bungled it, they've been repeatedly sued. And then they try to fix the ordinance and they bungle it again and they get sued. And so right now they're in the process of determining who can legally stay open. But, you know, in contrast, the oil tax, Proposition O, which would have, in fact, raised $4 million a year in new revenue, failed.
So
it was the only measure that passed.
Tax marijuana, but not tax oil.
Right. And so it was the one measure that failed.
Why? I mean, this would have been, I mean, I think I voted twice for this. And it's like, why wouldn't people vote to tax oil?
You know, the petroleum industry spent about $500,000 on mailers opposing it. Again, there was a lot of misinformation that this would increase gas prices, which isn't true because the city of LA doesn't set gas prices. The world market does. Also, there was information that it would unfairly harm small business owners. However, most of the oil fields in the city are not owned by small business owners. I think 3 of 55 fields are. So. And also,
somehow, small owner and owning oil sounds right? like an oxymoron.
Well, and then part of Prop O became a joke because in the course of the city deciding to put this on the ballot, so City Councilwoman Janice Hahn came into council literally one day and said, I think that we should tax oil. So let's put an oil tax on the ballot measure and we'll vote on it tomorrow. Tomorrow came, she came into council and said, you know what? I don't think that we should do this anymore. Because it's a bad idea. Because, of course, she had been called by all the oil producers saying, better not tax us. So her council member said, no, we still like this idea. It'll be $4 million a year. So they voted to put it on the ballot. She voted against it. She is now, so the whole thing looks just silly. She's now running for Congress to replace Congresswoman Jane Harman. So the week before the election, she sends out a whole big press release. Of course I support the oil tax. How could anybody say I'm not an environmentalist? And she tried to rewrite the course of what had happened. Of course, council meetings are filmed, and so it was easy enough to disprove that, you know.
But this is a really important issue, and my hunch is it will be back before the voters of California. The challenge is that the oil industry has deep pockets. We're one of the only states in the United States that don't tax oil coming out of the ground.
We're one of the only cities. I mean, right. Culver City does, Beverly Hills does. Right, so it's...
This is a bill potentially for education. There's an initiative being circulated that may fund public education on this issue. If the state passes an oil extraction tax, which Alaska, Texas, you name the state, oil-producing states around the country that tax it already at huge numbers. I mean... If California were to tax the oil, we would be able to close the funding shortfall for public education in a major way.
OK,
Okay, we have time maybe for one or two more, and then we're going to let you guys ask some questions. Remember, if you have some questions, especially if you want a good grade, you need to come up here and so that we can capture you on the mic. So start thinking about those questions. What other one was an interesting amendment?
Well, you say there's two other ones that are interesting. One was Measure L, which was for library funding. A little known fact, I think still a little known, is that the city charter actually carves out funding for two city departments specifically, and one is libraries, the other is parks. So this basically, it increased, I think it went from saying, you know, libraries get 0.175% of the assessed value on properties in the city to 0.3%. So it'll automatically, libraries will get more out of the next budget cycle. It was opposed by the Police Protective League, who said that's fine, that, you know, it's, everybody likes libraries, but if you specifically carve out this amount of money, you're automatically taking money away from other city services, such as police services or the fire department or sanitation.
Well, and that's an interesting issue, because that's ballot box budgeting.
Yes.
And it is not generally a good idea, because when you elect somebody, you want them to make decisions, especially in difficult times. And the more you legislate or on the ballot decide how to spend state money, the more likely you can't fix holes like we have in the state budget or the city budget, because they don't have enough discretionary funds mm-hmm. to do anything. Community colleges, for example, Governor Brown has suggested cutting $400 million from our community colleges around California. 85% or more of a budget in a community college or a K-12 is personnel. And so the discretionary part of our decision making is very small.
So May 17th is the runoff, and we've seen all of these elections. Who's going to be on that May 17th ballot? For sure, Scott Svonkin,
right.
Number one.
Right.
For sure, the congressional race.
Correct.
Okay. Probably the school board race with Sanchez.
Right.
Probably not the council race with Parks.
Unlikely.
Right. Does it benefit your campaign to have Sanchez and Parks also be on the ballot?
Well, based on election results, I did really well in the Bernie Parks area. So yes, it would benefit me if Bernie Parks was in a runoff. But in some ways, it benefits me that the congressional race more. Those communities voted for me in higher numbers. I did really well in Beverly Hills and West Hollywood. I did really well in the 14th. I was hoping Mitchell would have a runoff, because that would have helped me. The Luis Sanchez race, I didn't do as well in that race, in that community, as I did across Los Angeles. But I did beat my opponent 2-1 plus just about everywhere.
Right, right. Okay, any questions?
So my question is that I've noticed, as we're going through the slides, that a lot of the things that are affecting the election right now is just a lack of voter turnout and I think that comes from a lack of education. So as a journalist, what are the things that you see that are missing to educate the voters on these, you know, municipal and city elections as a politician? What are your approaches to getting your voice heard on your personal opinions, whether it comes to your campaign or the initiatives that are being voted on? Because having not been a political science student here, I probably wouldn't have known about these elections.
Yeah, why isn't the media doing its job? I'm just rephrasing her question.
No, fair enough. I get that every day. I think the media is doing its job in some ways. If you look at the coverage between the LA Times, the Daily News, television, the blogs, there is a lot of coverage out there, but I think there's a couple of problems. I think one is making that bridge between what happens in City Hall and how it affects people who live in Los Angeles. And I think the media probably could do a better job of explaining why it matters and why a person would be impacted. The other problem is typically, at least with I think with the ballot measures, mm-hmm. it's easy enough to say people are totally out to lunch on that one. But with
so is the council, according to the way
there,
you talked
yeah.
about.
but with the council races, it's very unusual that there's a challenging race for council. You know, usually the incumbents win. Even this time, incumbents won with serious challengers. And I think that's probably demoralizing to voters, because it's easy to feel like your vote doesn't count if you want to vote for somebody other than the incumbent.
So you says you were a reporter with the City News Service from 2005 mm-hmm. to 2009. What is the City News Service?
City News Service is the largest regional wire service in America. So it's like the AP, if people know what the AP is, for Southern California. And basically when you see breaking news on Channel 7, or if you're listening to the headlines on KPCC or KNX when you drive home, that's from City News Service.
Okay, who is that a nonprofit or is it a for-profit? Who pays people?
It's a for-profit. It's a family-owned company, but it's a subscription service. And the subscriptions are purchased by media companies, political offices, nonprofits, PR companies, people like that.
Okay. And then it says also that you are currently the vice president of the Greater Los Angeles Chapter of the Society of Professional Journalists. What is that?
Yes. The Society of Professional Journalists is the country's largest and oldest organization for journalists. So it's intended for professional development of mm-hmm. journalists. It also takes positions on freedom of information or First Amendment bills. It's a way for reporters to connect with each other and to stay on top of issues that affect journalists.
And we've all heard about all the challenges that journalism is facing, the lack of jobs, the lack of, I mean, the LA Times is half the size that it used to be. Television mm-hmm. news is half of what it used to be. And now when you turn on the local TV news, it's really entertainment news. They mm-hmm. hardly cover anything else.
Yeah.
The local PBS, which is not even a PBS station anymore,
right.
used to have public affairs. They hardly have that. What's the? Would you, if there was a student out here who said, I want to be a journalist, would you encourage them to be a journalist?
I would.
There are no jobs.
Well, you have to make your own job. So if you want to be a journalist these days, you have to be an entrepreneur, and you have to have a lot of skills. And that's new media skills, it's business skills, it's marketing. I think you have to realize you have to become your own brand if you're a journalist and mm-hmm. realize what that stands for.
So do you think most journalists are up to being entrepreneurs?
I think it depends where you are in your career and what your choices and limitations are.
But it's a completely different world than it used to be.
Yeah, I mean, you say the LA Times is half the size that it was, which is true, but it's compared to, I think, like 5 years ago, not even a decade ago.
Right.
I mean, it is decimated.
Yeah.
Well, hey, Fernando, yeah, the interesting thing is that the LA Times and the Daily News didn't endorse in the community college races. So the public, while they ran a six-part expose, which is something that I haven't seen in decades. I mean, it's rare that they invest that much time and energy, and rightfully so. There are a lot of problems in the community college system, especially in the bond program. But I think the important thing is, and I think the new media is going to be sort of the way your generation decides whether to vote or not. I spent a lot of my time on my campaign, on my Facebook page, communicating with voters. And President Obama was, I think, one of the first to engage people over the internet. Now, while I didn't raise a lot of money like President Obama did on the internet, I did communicate with people on Facebook. I have some 1,300 friends, and I'm relying.
Just get your friends to vote and you'll win.
That's the key.
Really.
Is if you find Scott Svonkin on Facebook and friend me and tell somebody to vote for me, that's the way I'm going to win this race, because very few people are going to even know there's an election on May 17th if you don't live in Jane Harmon's seat or if there's the runoff in the school board race.
Right.
Very few people. I'm hoping the LA Times and the Daily News decide to look at my race, because there's a huge contrast between myself and my opponent. Thank you.
There
we go. Do you live in Los Angeles or one of the 35
Actually,
cities?
I'm a student from PCC. I just transferred.
Great.
And my question would be, I'm pretty sure you're aware of that in community college, there are like huge problems getting classes and teachers would get laid off. So what would you do if you get in the office with all the limited...
Well, I appreciate that. The community colleges are facing, as I said earlier in the program, $400 million in cuts, because Governor Brown doesn't have a lot of choices. So he's taking $500 million from the UCs, he's taking $500 million from the CSUs, and he's taking $400 million from the community colleges. Having spent half my career in business and run my own business, I want to bring some of my business experience to the problems of the community colleges. There is no food service on the campuses. There's very little, if any, advertising. We should be able to do what LA Unified's doing and sell space on the campus to Nike and Apple and generate revenue to support classroom activities. The other thing is when we make cuts, they should be as far away from the students and the classes as we can. We also should use technology to make it easier for once a student starts a program to ensure that they have priority to finish. Because we need nurses, and we train most of the nurses in Los Angeles through the LA community colleges. And so once somebody starts the nursing program, we want them to get through it and out because there's a shortage of nurses. So I want to work with the business community in Los Angeles to find opportunities for them to come to our campus and for them to make money and for the students to get jobs in food service and get training so they can go out and open their own restaurants and work in the culinary arts. But we by opening up restaurants on our campuses and charging the corporations. So we've got to work with corporations, we've got to work with the business industry because we can't rely on state government any longer for all of the funds.
We are on the campus of Loyola Marymount University discussing the March 8th city elections with Alice Walton, the publisher and editor of citymaven.com, and Scott Svonkin, candidate for Los Angeles Community College District. Alice, what is citymaven.com?
Citymaven.com is my website. It launched in November, and it's a one-woman show. It's me. It's news articles about city government. I work out of City Hall.
So your own boss, your own editor.
Yes.
So you approve everything that you write?
I do. Right. So I write, I research, I do the tech side, the marketing, the business side.
And how do you decide what to write?
Sure. A couple of different ways. One thing I try to do is find angles on stories that people mm-hmm. aren't already covering. So if the LA Times and the Daily News and KTLA are all taking the same position on a story, try to find a different angle that mm-hmm. people aren't talking about. Also, I'm trying to kind of build that bridge that I referred to where why should people care what happens in City Hall? It sounds really boring, and sometimes it is. But the boring stuff is really important. You know, the city right now is facing a $400 million deficit for next year.
Right.
I mean, the city could go bankrupt. There are people out there who think the city will go bankrupt in 4 years. I don't know if that's true, but I think that sounds really important. And yeah. If you like having police or your garbage picked up or your trees trimmed or your sidewalks done or, you know, that's important stuff.
So do you ever get tips from anonymous sources?
All the time.
Yeah?
Yeah, all the time. There's plenty of people out there who are happy to share stuff as long as their name's not attached to it. Yeah.
And like, of the tips, how many have actually proven to be good stories and accurate to the way they were described to you?
It really depends on the person. And that's why at a certain point, you realize who's giving you good stuff, and you keep listening to them, and you take them to coffee, and you check in with them every once in a while and know that if they give you something good, you have to move on it. There's other people who are full of ideas and they can keep them. Right. I mean, if I have somebody give me a tip and it doesn't pan out, they get one other shot. If I have somebody who gives me two bad tips, I won't take anything from them
again.
No
wonder she never takes my calls.
Well, it's the same if a source lies to a reporter. Do you think the reporter's ever going to talk to that person again?
No.
Exactly.
So how do you monetize this? Is it that you sell space on your site and then you, mm-hmm. the number of hits and all that?
So right now the immediate goal of the site is to be building up traffic and building up the content. And it's been really good about – people are good about linking to the site, getting the site mentioned in the LA Weekly or on KCRW and things like that. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to build the audience. So there is an audience to monetize by putting out ads. If I put up ads right now, I'd make about $1.25 a month.
So that's
the little thing about ads on websites. You have to have a really big audience to make any money.
So if a student was working on an article on LA politics or something like mm-hmm. that, your website would be a good one to take a look at in terms of what stories have been happening, et cetera.
Yeah, absolutely. I would say so. There's a number of posts a day about any number of things happening in the city.
Let's talk a little bit about, Scott mentioned it. There was a 6-part expose about the community college district and how it has been doing construction. It was tremendous coverage by the LA Times. Mm-hmm. One of the surprising things to me And the LA Times also did the expose on the city of Bell. Mm-hmm. They started that whole process about investigating the city of Bell, which then led to the television media to really pick up on that, as did other newspapers, and it really grew like wildfire. Everybody knows about Bell across the state and across the country about the type of corruption that was occurring. And so the Times really hit it big with Bell, and that whole coverage. I haven't seen the same thing with the community college district. I mean, I think the Times then wrote the sixth part, then they've written other news stories about, as Scott mentioned, the DA maybe prosecuting something, the district firing some people, but I have not seen a single article or a single TV station pick up the story. Why is that, and how is that different than Bell? Corruption's corruption.
It is. I think maybe, I don't know why it's not picked up. I think there's a couple of possibilities. One, with a city like Bell, or if you have an elected official who is taking money and doing bad things, I think it's clearer maybe who the victim is or who's injured by that. You know, it's the people who live in the city. I think maybe with the community college district, it's more difficult for people to understand who's injured by that. Certainly people are, and you can say the students are injured, anybody who pays taxes are injured.
Correct.
But for the reader to feel that connection, I think is maybe more difficult. Because if you read the Bell stuff and you lived in Bell, you really felt mad. Mm-hmm. And also, just for the reader, it's easier to understand, well, I live in a city, and if my councilman was doing that, I would be really upset and I would want them prosecuted. So I don't know if maybe that's part of it. I think the timing of the series is really interesting because it's a great series of stories, but they ran it the week before the election, right into the election. And if they wanted to really make an impact, why not run it a month ago or 2 months ago where you could really take the time to talk about it during your race and the incumbents could talk about it and there would be a lot more discussion. It kind of felt like it just ran into the election. And there's such a hangover from the election as far as reporters are concerned that,
There were two reporters who covered this quite extensively. Yeah. And they've been doing it. They started working on this story over a year ago.
I think it's been a year and a half.
20 months. Mm-hmm. 20 months. And many, most people at the community college district knew that this was happening.
Coming.
They were just waiting for the shoe to drop and for the story to come out. Scott, are you surprised at the timing of when the story was released, number one, and then number two, that nobody else has picked it up? I keep saying nobody. Maybe somebody has, but I have not seen. And I try to consume all news. I'm on, the city, maven.com, every single day.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
So, tell all your Facebook friends, too.
I don't have Facebook friends. Nobody friends me for some reason.
Well, Scott has 1,300, so you should tell some people.
Oh, Scott, Scott's face.
If you write an article about my race and it's positive, I'll link.
Yeah.
The issues in the community college district are complicated, and it's public funds and some lack of oversight and management that was really egregious. And then there's other issues involved. But I think the problem, Fernando, was that the stories were incredibly complicated. And I went through them line by line and made notes and looking for how do I reform the system. And I expected that they would, as a non-incumbent, I thought the LA Times would come to me and talk to me about my ideas. And while one of the reporters interviewed me, none of my ideas for reform made any of the stories that were just before the election. So, I'm continuing to pursue that. I'm going to be looking at how do we reform the district, because even if nobody's watching, that's what I'm elected to do, and I think that's what the voters want. Because the voters don't really know who we are on the community college, there's one story the LA Times does, and the Daily News does one story about the community college race. Well, the LA Times has been only focused on the bond program, which needs to be fixed. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that has to happen is we have to have strong public oversight. The current bond oversight committee thought everything was okay, but that was because they weren't getting all the information. The Times dug for 20 months to get this information, and the public had it, 6 days of it. I think the public didn't quite digest it all, and I think they're going to rely on people like myself and the other board members to actually dig down deep and fix this. But if the problem is there's no beat reporter on the community colleges anymore. just like very few stations have somebody in Sacramento. I mean, almost none of the when years ago, every TV station had a reporter in Sacramento. The LA Times and the Daily News had people in Sacramento every day. That's no longer the case. And so it's a sad commentary that there's not a lot of jobs for reporters, because they're the public's eyes, they're the public watchdog. And the LA Times tries to do it, but you know, they didn't even have the staff to endorse. There were 15 people running for 4 seats, and I'm told that's why they didn't endorse, not because they didn't want to, but because it takes so many man hours to interview, especially people like me who like to talk.
So now there'll only be one race, so maybe they'll do that.
I'm hoping.
In a nutshell, what were the stories about?
Well, they were about a lack of oversight. They were about serious mistakes in a $5 billion construction program. And so you know that there were a lot of mistakes, but a lot of really amazing buildings were built. So we have $2 billion in the community colleges left to spend to improve the 9 campuses. And I think the most important thing is, how do we fix it? I do want to hold all of those folks accountable. One of the top administrators in charge of the building program's gone, and that's...
Did he quit or was he fired?
That's an interesting question. I think the story was he was fired. But you know, whether he quit or was fired, he's gone, and now we have to reform the system and make sure the public is the one overseeing it, and that trustees like myself, I mean, I decided not to take money from folks doing business with the district so that there's no conflict of interest. I'm hoping that kind of reform happens in a real significant way, because these are public dollars that will determine the future of our young people, because the campuses, I mean, this is a Loyola Marymount. I haven't been here before. This is a beautiful campus, and I'm pleased to be here with you tonight, because this is the kind of campus that community college students deserve.
I mean, we had, the community college system had built a bell tower, like our bell tower, but it was crooked.
Right.
What were some of the other examples?
Well, I mean, there was a
crooked bell tower. I mean, it could have been like the Leaning Tower of Pisa.
There's a football field that's not usable. There were a number of...
Well, we don't have a football team that we use, so it's like it would have been...
But there were a number of mistakes that were serious, and people should be held accountable. There were buildings planned where they did the entire planning and architecture, and then they scrapped them after you know, millions of dollars spent and wasted. I think that there's clearly a need for real oversight, but it was the LA Times in the 20 months they spent that got this at the forefront. The challenge will be making sure that these things are fixed. And if the LA Times and the Daily News and the important other news sources don't follow the story about how do we fix it, I'm not sure there'll be the will to fix everything. You know, I'm hoping that we continue to have this dialogue, because it's public funds and it's $2 billion left to be spent. That's a huge number.
This is all the time that we have. We want to welcome and thank Alice Walton, publisher and editor of the citymaven.com, and Scott Svonkin, currently a member of the San Gabriel Unified School District and a candidate for the Los Angeles Community College Board. Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.